April 6th, 2014. The DNA of God. Let's pray. Father, anoint your people with eyes to see and ears to hear. Anoint your servant with your word as we empty ourselves, vessels for your use, and yield now to your Holy Spirit. In your name we pray, and the saints say in agreement, Amen. Satan, we bind you all in holy cherubim, thrones, dominions, seraphim, principalities, powers, rulers, wicked spirits in outer space, territorials, elementals, and strongman spirits on assignment, all above, around, and below the strongman spirit, all spirits not of the Holy Spirit. All of your works and efforts, which we curse at the roots, render of no effect, and bind up and off all retaliations, counterattacks, judgment, wraths, revenge, or reprisals, in any way, manner, or form against any of our loved ones, born or unborn, or any of our ministry peoples and their loved ones here or overseas, those of our radio or internet audiences, those who pray for us daily and regularly, those for whom we pray, have a burden, petition, and counter-petition, and ourselves, and decree all such immediately, permanently, and perpetually forbidden, and bind them up and off from doing so, all in Christ Jesus' name. The saints say in agreement, Amen. We continue our teaching on the DNA of God, and over the last two sessions, we have been talking about our access to the court of heaven, particularly for difficult problems, difficult issues, for which we cannot seem to find resolution even through prayer or intercession. And in our last session, we talked about the protocol of how we go in to the court of heaven and what we do and how we do it. And if you've missed that, I strongly recommend that you get that CD and review that, because it is an extremely important concept that there is such a thing as the court of heaven, and that you have direct access to it because the scripture says you are a son of God. Huh? A son of God. Now, our proof text has been Psalm 82, verse 1 and 2. And this is what it says. God stands up to open heaven's court. How about that? Psalm 82, verse 1. God stands up to open heaven's court. And then the next sentence says, he pronounces judgment among the gods. Or he judges among the gods with a small g. Now, hold on a minute. Who are the gods? You and I are the gods, aren't we? Huh? In Isaiah, is it not written, is it not written, ye are gods? And didn't Jesus quote that in the New Testament? Is it not written, ye are gods? God says that you are a God with a small g. Why? Because you are made in his image and likeness. And 1 Corinthians 6:17 says, he who is Christ is one spirit. It's because of covenant. You see? Because of all that he has done and none that we have done. It is all covenant. So it is true that we are gods. And now Psalm 82 verse 1 says God stands up to open heaven's court, and then it says he judges among the gods. That means that the gods have to be able to go to the heavenly court that he opens up. Is that not true? Are we all on the same wavelength? I think we are. Now what this is simply saying is that heaven has a court, and the court that heaven has is structurally an entity which operates by law, just like earthly courts operate by law, but the law is not earthly law. The law is the law of God, and that is the difference. Now, we know that in the heavenly court, Father God is the presiding judge. He is the Supreme Court judge of the universe. Father God. We know that the Lord Jesus Christ is the mediator or the attorney who prosecutes for us. And we also know that whenever we bring a legal action in that court, that Satan will be there to try to defend his right to do what he is doing. And so when we prepare to go into the heavenly court, we have to first summon Satan to appear in front of the judge so that we may accuse him of the violations of our rights given to us by the written law of God. And then he will try to defend himself. But guess what? He will not be able to prevail, and I will show you why he will not be able to prevail as we go on through the study today. And so, there are conditions, we said, to enter the court. And the court is a type of a legal court, but as I said, the law is the law, the Word of God. And Jesus gave us this example in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 18. And he showed us the model on earth and how we should, what we should do with the heavenly model as a consequence of the model on earth. Listen to what it says. This is Luke 18, verse 1 to 8. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and ought not faint, saying, there was in a city a judge who feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said. Now watch this, verse 7. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, shall he find faith on the earth? Now that's a mistranslation. It doesn't say, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth. The actual Greek in the original Greek says, when the Son of Man comes, will he find the faith on the earth? Not people's faith. Will he find faith on the earth? That's people's faith. Okay? No. Will he find the faith on the earth? That is the doctrine of Christ as it was originally given to the early church. The early church. Okay? Before the end-time church became apostate. The end-time church doesn't talk about its apostasy. We are all to some degree apostate. Okay? But some of us don't care to be apostate and search out the truth and do our best to walk in the truth. And that's what the early church did, to the best of their ability. And so, that's what he meant. Will he find the faith in the earth? Will he find the original gospel that was preached? Jesus Christ, the Savior of all men, especially those who believe. 1 Timothy 4:10, the true gospel. That Jesus Christ is the Savior of the all, the Greek says. That means the whole of the creation and everything in it. Everything in it. That every knee will bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. Huh? That's the original gospel. Will he find that? Yes, he will. Yes, he will. By faith we believe, yes, he will. Now let's go back to verse 7 and 8. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Where? In the court of heaven. In the court of heaven. That's where. In the court of heaven. So here we see that God is giving us a message. Just as the woman went to the unfair judge and couldn't get a response from him, so what did she do? She kept going back and going back and going back and going back. And she persisted until the judge ruled in her favor. Well, what is the meaning of this? What is Jesus saying? I will avenge them speedily. Come boldly to the throne of grace, that you may receive mercy and compassion in your time of need. Where is the throne of grace? In the court of heaven. That's where it is. And so, if we understand that principle, then we understand that sometimes, just as this woman had to persist and persevere with the unfair judge, that in the court of heaven, we may have to return one or two or three more times in our hearing. Why? To persist against Satan, the unfair judge. You see? Okay? Because Satan will be there with his documents. Did you know Satan has written documents? The scripture says that there are documents, scrolls, in heaven with information about us on them. And those documents are brought into the court, just like a human court has legal documents. Huh? Okay? And when we go into that court of heaven, Satan will be there with his written documents. Because he copies everything Jesus does. Okay? And he is a prosecuting attorney, or so he thinks. Except he fails to realize that the real prosecutor in the court of heaven is Jesus. And what he's going to do is prosecute him. You see? And so we will go and we will be prepared to make our statement before God regarding the problem. We will declare ahead of time Satan summoned to the court so that we can accuse him directly. Isn't that a delightful idea? A believer accusing the accuser of the brethren. That's a neat idea, don't you think? We should do that every day, I think. Huh? Every day should be court day. Right. Okay. So what we do is we have to prepare a ready defense. So we cannot enter the courts being in the flesh, can we? Huh? No. We've got to leave our flesh at the doorway. And that means that we have to be in line with the Word of God to go into the court of heaven. And what does the Word say? Jesus said, Satan has nothing in me. If Satan has nothing in him, if we are going to go into the court of heaven, Satan must have nothing in us to accuse us of. So the very first thing we start out with is examination, self-examination, confession and repentance. Huh? Why? Psalm 127, verse 1 says, who can stand on the hill of the Lord except he who has a pure heart and clean hands? Huh? Who can stand on the hill of the Lord except he who has a pure heart and clean hands? So we must go with a pure heart and clean hands before the Lord, and the only way that's going to happen is through self-examination, confession, and repentance. And that must be a daily thing in our lives. We must stay clean before God, depending on his righteousness in us and through us to justify us. Huh? That's how we approach all of this. And then when we go, because of what Jesus gave us, the model of the court and the woman in the earthly level, and showed us that just like her, we have to be persistent. We go into that court with the idea that we are going to be persistent until we get the victory and until the court rules in our favor. Now, the court of heaven is not like other courts. It's not like human courts. In the court of heaven, of all those Spirit-filled, Bible-believing believers, the Philadelphia church, the remnant, all who go into of the remnant that go into the court of heaven to ask for justice. What percentage of the cases rule in the favor of the plaintiff who goes into the court to bring action against Satan? 100%. You're right. 100%. See, it isn't man's way, okay? It's not like God said one day to Jeremiah, "Jeremiah, we're having a court session today, and I think that you should act as the plaintiff's attorneys before them. And go before God and just present the cases, and let's get a bunch of them done today." And Jeremiah walks into the court, and he's nervous and he's sweating, and he's never done this before, and he doesn't know what to do. And so he starts presenting the person's complaint to Father God, and then starts telling Father God her credentials and what she's done right. And, you know, yes, she's done some wrong, but she's got a good heart toward you, God. And she needs relief from this situation, or relief from that situation. And she's standing on this verse, and she's standing on that verse. And Father, we just ask you to rule in her favor, and this and that. And he's wiping his brow as he's sweating, okay, in front of Father God. And he continues on and on, praising the person's virtues, why this person has a right to bring this case to the court in heaven, before Father God and all. And then we see Jesus. And Jesus says to Jeremiah, "Jeremiah, this is taking too long. And you're working yourself up into a tizzy. Why don't you just go sit down and now I'll take over. I'll take over." And so Jeremiah sits down, and Jesus just walks up to the bench. And when Jesus walks up to the bench and he says, "Father, of all that the enemy here is accusing this person of, I have paid the price at the cross, and it is all paid for, and every evil has been put away. So the enemy's accusations have no legal ground in this court whatsoever, because I have paid the price for all of her wrongdoings and all of her sins. I suggest that you dismiss this case, and Father, rule in her favor." And Father God slams the gavel, boom! Case dismissed. We rule in the favor of this believer, in the name of Christ Jesus. Next case, please. And he comes in, and this time Jeremiah sits down and doesn't do anything, and the person just presents the case, says what Satan is doing against them, and how Satan is bothering them, and what is happening, and how Satan doesn't stop. And Jesus walks up to Father and says, "Father, I paid the price for it all. I do suggest that you dismiss this case and write a order to cease and desist against Satan, and dispatch warrior angels to destroy that stronghold. There's no legal ground for it. I paid the price for everything. Case dismissed." Next. And that's how Jesus operates. That's what the court of heaven is all about. The court of heaven is nothing like an earthly court. Okay? All the decisions have been made ahead of time in the court of heaven. Okay? And you cannot have a better deal in the court of heaven because you are a son of God. So if you go into the court of heaven and the judge is your father and the defense attorney is your brother, I think you've got a pretty good deal going there, don't you? Sure you do. Because it's all been paid for, huh? It's all been paid for. And when you go into the court of heaven, watch this. You must walk by the Spirit, because the things of the Spirit are spirit, the Scripture says. Huh? Okay? Now that means you've got to reckon yourself as dead to sin. That's why you confess and repent ahead of time, huh? You reckon yourself as dead to sin. Because if Satan wants to pull out his written documents, and he wants to accuse you of sin ahead of time, guess what? He's not going to be able to. The court will not allow it to be admitted as evidence. The court will not allow him to submit it because it's all been paid for. And it does not exist in the court records. There is no evidence for it in the court records. So you don't have to worry about that. But you must be persistent in coming against him. And so you go into the court, you present your case, you give the evidence, which is the Scripture you stand on, huh? You've summoned Satan, you tell the judge what's going wrong and what he's doing wrong, how you've not been able to get breakthrough, that he's been coming against you and you're not even in his kingdom. So he has no legal right to come against you. Huh? Okay? And that you're requesting the court to destroy his strongholds and to stop him and to write a cease and desist order and present it to him and cause him to end all that he is doing in the name of Christ Jesus. And we gave you that protocol last week. Now, when you do that, you stand on that and you ask the court to rule in your favor. You ask the court to rule in your favor. And when you do that, keep in mind that when you talk in the court and you are speaking the word of God that you're standing on, and you are pleading with Father to take an action against Satan and all under him who have this stronghold formed against you for whatever reason, okay, you have to use spirit-filled words, empowered words, words that are based on the revelation of the word. They are your legal rights. See that? They are your legal rights. The words that you are standing on. I go into the court. I say, Father, this stronghold has been opposing me for years, and I have not yet received relief through intercession or through supplication, prayer, and all, and the enemy persists, and he has no legal ground in me. I am not part of his kingdom. I have confessed all ancestral sin. I have repented of all personal sin. Your word says, and I stand as the evidence, your word, which says, no weapon formed against me prospers or seeds. For when the enemy comes in, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise a standard against them. For I take refuge in you, at your right hand, at your right side, in the shadow of your wings, and in your name, and I am not put to shame nor disgraced. That's your word, Father, and I take you at your word. And I ask you now, Father, to perform your word and to rule against him. And I ask of the court that warrior angels be dispatched now to destroy that stronghold and to tear it down and to drive them off of me and my loved ones and to surround us until we're safely home in glory with a hedge of protection, all in your name and to your glory, Lord Christ. And I ask the Lord, and I ask the court to rule now and to grant this. And Jesus steps up and he says, Father, I have paid for all sin and all legal grounds. Satan has no right to do that. I agree with the plaintiff, and I suggest you rule in his favor and dismiss any other action that the enemy is trying to oppose with. And Father God slams the gavel and releases grace from the throne, releases warrior angels to go forth to destroy strongholds, and all of a sudden things change and start getting better. Come boldly to the throne of grace that you may receive mercy and compassion in your time of need. But notice what the first part of the verse is, that you may receive. Come boldly to the court of heaven. Come boldly to the throne of grace that you may receive. You have rights in heaven. You have rights on earth, and you have rights in heaven. Christ is your mediator. In Romans 8:33, 34, and 35, we read, "Who shall lay anything to charge of God's elect?" In other words, who in the heavenly court will charge anything against us? That's what that means. Who in the heavenly court will charge us with anything? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies. Who is he that condemns? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. He's in the court. He is our great intercessor. He is our prosecutor of Satan. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Now, in our last session, I said we can also go into the court for others. Okay? To intercede for others, on behalf of others. We can go into the court on behalf of ancestors who have died, and they never got to fulfill their purposes in Christ, and they never got to use the fullness of the anointings. And we can claim their purposes, and we can claim their anointings in court, and ask God to pass those down to us, so that we may fulfill those purposes and those anointings for them. Yes. And that's, by the way, in Hebrews 11, 39, and 40. Listen to what it says. "And all these, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise." See? God having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. You see, it talks there in Hebrews about those who never received the promise. They never got to fulfill their purpose in Christ. They never got to use their anointings because Satan thwarted it. He stopped it. And he destroyed many of their lives in the process. And we can go before the throne of heaven, and we can bring that up to God and ask for him to avenge them, and ask for him to rule in their favor and pass that inheritance down to us. See? To pass that inheritance down to us. Did you know? I don't know whether you know this or not. Did you know that if they fulfilled those purposes that God had for them, and if they fulfilled the purpose of the anointings God gave them, that the blessings that they would have inherited from doing that would have come down to you? And that's the legal right that you have to go to God and say, "Father, I want those things back." Satan had no entitlement to them. He had no right to destroy my family line. He had no right to come against them. He had no right to steal their purposes. He had no right to steal their anointings. He had no right to steal my blessings, which I and maybe 1,000 generations ahead of me would have inherited according to the Abrahamic covenant if he had not interfered. Huh? Are we getting somewhere? You see? These are our right. You can go and you can place a demand against Satan for reparation. Yes, you can. It's in the Word of God. It's in the Word of God. You can intercede for others as well. Even if they're not saved, you can intercede for them and get a ruling from the court of heaven. That's in the Scriptures also. Job 22:30. Speaking of Father God, he shall deliver even one who is not innocent, and he is delivered by the pureness of your hands. Isn't that something? Huh? And he is delivered by the pureness of your hands. Wow, we can go into the court of heavens and we can plead for people who are not saved, who are not innocent, or who are guilty of something else, but for whom some sort of exceptions should be made. Maybe mercy, compassion, based on other things of their lives. Ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock, it will be opened unto you. Start operating in the Word. Start applying the Word of God and watch God work. Back it with faith. Back it with holy expectation. Be bold. Come boldly to the throne of grace. By the way, that's an invitation. That's an invitation. Come boldly to the throne of grace. Can I have water? Yeah. Come boldly to the throne of grace that you may receive. So when we come into the court, we're not going to come as timid, little fearful people. You get at the door of the court. And you look, I'm here. No, it doesn't work that way. Come boldly to the throne of grace. I walk in the court and I walk up. Father, I give you thanks, praise, and glory for who you are. And I love you and I praise you. You are my Father. Father, let me tell you about this scoundrel here. And you point to Satan. See? And what he has done. And what he is doing in our family. Okay? And he's got no right to do it. And Father, I come and ask for action from the court against him. See? Come boldly to the throne of grace. My goodness. Now watch this. Luke 22:31. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. And Revelation of John 12:10. And I heard a voice saying in the heaven, now is come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Can you imagine? Satan goes to heaven and he accuses people before God day and night. And that's all he does is accuse and accuse and accuse and accuse. And God has to listen to that every day, 24 hours a day, every day of the year, for billions of years. I mean, if that doesn't give you Excedrin headache number 5, I don't know what will. Huh? I mean, could you imagine he does that? And God, in his grace and in his glory and in his patience, just sits there and listens and ignores it. Because the accuser of the brethren has been cast down, the Scripture says. So when you go into the court of heaven, You can cancel Satan's claims against you through Christ's salvation. Through the finished work of the cross, you can cancel Satan's claims. He cannot accuse you. It says the accuser of the brethren has been cast down. That occurred at the cross. His power was taken from him, and that includes his power to accuse. So, you can enter demands against him. That's the point. So when Satan wants to accuse, okay, you just say, Father, I bind that in Christ Jesus' name. Because he has no legal ground to accuse in this court. He has been cast down. The Word of God says it. I invoke as the evidence of the law, John 12, verse 10. You can enter demands. Has Satan stolen from you? You can enter demands for reparation. The scripture says, if a thief be found, he shall restore sevenfold. He shall not give all the substance of his house. He shall give all the substance of his house. So if Satan has stolen from you or your loved ones and you're claiming something in the court of heaven and you're claiming reparation, you stand on Proverbs 6:31. The thief has been caught. He must give me, Father, seven times what he has stolen and all that is in his house in Christ Jesus' name, all of the treasure. And by the way, that also is supported by the scripture that says, in the last days, the wealth of the wicked is reserved for the righteous. Huh? The wealth of the wicked is reserved for the righteous. Huh? Okay. You have court authority. Yes, you do. You have court authority. I give you power to trample over serpents and scorpions and authority over all the power of the enemy. Huh? Over all the power of the enemy. Now, let's ask a question. And the question is this. We all know now that we have this authority. And we all know now how to use it. The question now that we want to go a little deeper into this, a little deeper. And the question now that we want to ask is this. What is the basis through the finished work of the cross that permits us to do this? Well, the very first thing is we have the DNA of God. Every seed reproduces after its own kind. Huh? The scripture says that Christ was generated from the Father, begotten of the Father. The word begotten is Old English, and it literally means generated from. Begotten of the Father. And then the New Testament scripture says that we have been born from above. Geneo in the Greek means generated from. From who? The Creator. Who is the Creator? Jesus. All things were made through him, and by him were made nothing that has been made. That includes you and I. Huh? That includes you and I. So, what we see then is we are generated from Jesus. Jesus is generated from the Father. We are generated from Jesus. Every seed reproduces after its own kind. And Jesus says, is it not written, ye are gods? So the means by which we do this begins with the understanding that we are gods. Let me just find a verse here. So, what is it that causes us to have access to heaven? The answer to that is the finished work of the cross. It all begins at the cross. The finished work of the cross. What are we called to do? We are called by the Holy Spirit. I got the wrong verse here. Hold on. We are called by the Holy Spirit to put into place the finished work of the cross among the people of the world on the earth. That's what we are called for. To execute the judgments of God on the earth. And I'm going to explain this to you now. Okay? Colossians 2, verse 13 to 15 explains it all. And this is the foundational concept of how we have access to the court of heaven. Because we have access to God. We have access to Jesus. We have access to the Holy Spirit first. And we have that through the finished work of the cross. It all comes back to the finished work of the cross. Listen to Colossians 2, verse 13 to 15, and what it says. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, has he quickened together with him, has made alive together with him. That's Jesus, having forgiven you all trespasses, having forgiven you all sin, blotting out the handwriting of ordinance that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. Now watch this. Notice what it says. Blotting out the handwriting of the ordinances of the law, the handwriting. These are the legal documents that Satan brings against you in court. It says he has blotted that all out by the finished work of the cross. Okay? That was against us. Well, if it's against us, it's from Satan. Huh? Are y'all with me? Okay? It says he has blotted out the handwriting of ordinances, that's a way of saying the legal documents. Okay? That was against us. In other words, that originated with Satan. The stuff that Satan brings into the court of heaven. And he's got ready to accuse you of. Here it is. Father, I invoke Colossians 2:14 that says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Father, it's been nailed to the cross. His written documents, his documents he's presenting here in court today are of no use. They are canceled. They are nullified. They are not even admissible to this court. In Jesus' name. Are we getting somewhere? And verse 15, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. In other words, after he defeated principalities and powers, he paraded them in the death state to humiliate them and to show that he had obtained victory over them and that they were defeated. So here we see, what does this tell us? Everything that is against us, and this is why you get the victory in the heavenly court. This verse tells us everything that is against us has been nailed to the cross. Jesus has nailed it all to the cross. Not only our sins, our transgressions, our faults, everything that we did wrong, everything we messed up. He nailed it to the cross. Every bad experience we had, He nailed it to the cross. Every wrong, humiliating thing we engaged in, He nailed it to the cross. Every embarrassing thing we ever did or ever said, He nailed it to the cross. So Satan will come to the door of the court of heaven with this stack of papers. Huh? And God will stop him at the door. And one of the cherubim, the holy cherubim, will say, "Sorry, you can't bring those in this court. Not admissible. They've been nailed to the cross." Mm-mm-mm. How great is our God. How great is our God. So then, if that's true, now watch this. See, we are going into the court of heaven with court authority. Court authority. Okay? Putting into place the finished work of the cross. That's our job as born-again believers, to build the body of Christ. Huh? To build it. Individual by individual. And so, what are we called to do? If everything that is against us has been nailed to the cross, then that means that we have to put it in place. Okay? That means that we have to enforce the verdict of the court of heaven. It's been put in the death work of the cross. We have to enforce that verdict given by the judge in the court of heaven. That's our job, to enforce the verdict. To say, whenever we see the enemy doing something that's illegal, "Oh, no, you don't. I bind you in the name of Christ Jesus, and I break your powers. And I loose so-and-so from you. And I release the Spirit of God upon her that you may not have her in Christ Jesus' name." See? Enforcing the verdict. All will be saved, the Scripture says. See? There's only two kinds of people on this earth. Scripture says, the earth is the Lord's and all that there is therein. All that there is therein. Okay? So we have saved people. Okay? And then we have the others that are unbelievers. But in God's eyes, what are they? They are saved people held kidnapped by Satan that have to be released yet. Why do I say that? Because the Scripture says Jesus Christ is the Savior of all. 1 Timothy 4:10. You don't believe that verse, you don't believe all the Bible. You've got a problem. So we're going to enforce the verdict. In Psalm 149, watch this. Verse 5 to 9. Great, great verses to confirm what we're teaching. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand. Now watch this. To execute judgment, to execute vengeance upon the heathen and punishments upon the people, to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron, to execute upon them the judgment written, this honor have all his saints, praise you the Lord. And I said, wow, what is that about? Well, let's go through it a little slower. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand. Well, that's not really an accurate translation. That two-edged sword appears also in Revelations chapter 1. Speaking of Jesus, it says, out of his mouth comes a two-edged sword. But that is not really what the Greek says. The Greek doesn't say two-edged. The Greek says, out of his mouth comes a double-mouthed sword. Ooh, isn't that interesting? A double-mouthed sword. Not a two-edged sword. A double-mouthed sword. Well, who's the first mouth of the double-mouthed sword? Jesus. Huh? And who is the second mouth of the double-mouthed sword? You and I. And how does that work? Romans 8:26, his spirit witnesses to our spirit that we are the sons of God. His spirit witnesses to our spirit that we are the sons of God. Once more, his spirit witnesses to our spirit that we are the sons of God. And what does that mean? That means that his spirit witnesses to us what we are to speak as sons of God, and then we speak it. He puts it on our heart, what we should say, and then we say it. We are the second mouth of the double-mouthed sword. Jesus, the Holy Spirit, is the first mouth. We are the second mouth of the double-mouthed sword. And with that, it says in verse 7, to execute vengeance upon the heathen and punishments upon the people, and to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron. Now, there is a spiritual significance to this. Okay, there's a rhema revelation behind this, and that's this. If you have ever been numbers of deliverances, as the Lord has granted me to be privileged to do over the years, you will discover that in the kingdom of darkness, the spirits name themselves kings and queens. For instance, there is a queen of the sea, which is a demon power over the oceans. Say, there is a king of the sea. The Greek used to call him Neptune. Huh? Okay, there are princes and there are chief princes as well. And there are nobles in their kingdom. Okay, and on occasion we've even seen those that have called themselves barons or dukes. See, the kingdom of darkness is chaotic, and the experience of many deliverance ministers who have dealt with them, I think the common agreement is that it's bizarre, to say the least. Bizarre. Strange. But that's what they do. And so here, where it says to bind their kings with chains, this is talking spiritually, not just physically. See? To bind their kings with chains, Psalm 149:8, and their nobles with fetters of iron. See? And we take authority and we bind them, don't we? You see? And that's here is what it says, to execute upon them the judgment written. By who? Father God. to execute upon them. We're to execute into place the finished work of the cross. See? We're to execute it into place. And that's what Psalm 149, 5-9 is telling us here. You see? We're to be used by God to execute judgments against the enemy. Not to defend ourselves in court, but to go into court with court authority as a son of God and presenting the case to the Father, saying what Satan cannot do, what he has done, summoning him there to be accused. Okay? And by the way, keep in mind that the court of heaven is the only place where Satan cannot accuse and get away with it. It's the only place in the universe where Satan cannot get away with accusing. It will not be permitted. Not by Father God, not by Jesus, not by you. Because you have the authority. I give you authority to trample over serpents and scorpions and power over all of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall harm you. I give you the power, okay, to trample over serpents and scorpions. That's the devil and the demons and the fallen angels. Huh? And nothing by any means shall harm you. Well, power over all the power of the enemy would include power over Satan. Huh? So you're not going into the court getting the idea in your head that Satan has any power whatsoever. It's been taken from him 2,000 years ago. And you have power over him. So you're going in with that authority. Why? Psalm 49 says, to execute upon them the judgment written. So if you're going to execute, execute. If you're going to trample, trample. Huh? Come boldly to the throne of grace. Take possession of what is yours. Do you know that you have a right to take possession of what is yours? Take possession of what is yours. Huh? Enforce the verdict. Our job, as it says here in Psalm 149:9, is to execute the judgment written, put it in place, and then put Satan in his place, in Jesus' name. Huh? Satan can't stand on anything. Why? In John 16:8, it says, and when he is come, that is the Holy Spirit, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of judgment. He will reprove the world of judgment. Satan will not. So he has no right in the heavenly court to accuse. That's the Holy Spirit's job, to judge, not Satan's. So he's got no legal ground to stand by, as we're seeing as we explore the word here. Okay? The Holy Spirit takes the finished work and he brings application of it through us to the world. That's what he does. Okay? What is the call of the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit has a calling. He is called in the scripture Melchizedek, King of Righteousness. Without genealogy, without mother, without father, priest unto an endless life, Ancient of Days. Melchizedek, he is the Holy Spirit. And what is his calling? His calling is to bring the whole of the creation and everything in it into the unity and fellowship with the Son of God. That is his calling. To bring the whole of the creation into the unity and fellowship with the Son of God. that every knee will bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And God doesn't want that by force, does he? He wants that by love, because God is love, the scripture says. Ah, you are destined for the throne. I am destined for the throne. You are destined to rule and reign with Christ. I am destined to rule and reign with Christ. So the Holy Spirit executes the verdict, and then he brings the verdict to us, and then we bring the verdict to the people of the earth. Huh? Isn't that something? Okay. And what happens? We get the blessing. Huh? We get the blessing. See, here's the point. At the cross, Jesus purchased a place for us in the kingdom of God. Okay? But the work of the cross completed the work of Jesus. But the work of the cross can't just stay at the cross. The work of the cross has to be delivered to us. And it can only be delivered to us by the Holy Spirit, who comes upon us and lives his life in us and through us, that we may walk out the blessing of the finished work of the cross, which is called salvation. And the word salvation in the Greek not only means being saved from sin, it also means being saved from self. And it also means being saved from circumstances. And it also means healing. And it also means deliverance. It means all of those things. Not just being saved from sin. Salvation means all those things. Isn't that something? And there it is at the cross. It's finished. But now it has to be conveyed to man. It has to be conveyed to mankind. Has to be delivered to man. And man has to receive it. And man has to walk in it. And then man has to distribute it. Ah. We have to distribute it. How? By revelation. Revelation. The kingdom is built by revelation. The body of Christ is built by revelation. We spread the revelation. It's all God's revelation anyway, right? But he delivers it to us, and we spread it, and the kingdom is built. And when the kingdom is built, the judgments are put in place that God desired for us to carry out, that righteousness may be seated on the earth, that holiness may be seated on the earth, that we may be to others a holy nation, a peculiar people, a royal priesthood. Wow. So there must be the delivery, and that's the work of the Holy Spirit. And what is our job? Our job is to move with him. Our job is to move with him. Be sensitive to him. Our job, okay, is to cooperate with him. Huh? To be tuned into him. Turn your radios on. Tune in to the Holy Spirit. Okay? You want to know why so many churches today are apostate? Well, number one, it's a fulfillment of prophecy. It has to happen because all prophecy must be fulfilled. Okay? But what is the working behind it that causes it to be fulfilled? The answer is that there is a problem with the end time church. And the problem is one of hearing. Let him who has ears to hear, hear, Jesus says. Now, I don't know about what your Bible says, but my Bible says that the Holy Spirit is on the earth and that he will lead us into all truth. Does your Bible say that? My Bible says that. He will lead us into all truth. Well, if the Holy Spirit is on the earth to lead us into all truth, then why is the end time church apostate? Apostasy means falling away from the truth of the word as originally intended by the Holy Spirit. Why is the church apostate? If the Holy Spirit is on the earth to lead all into truth, why is the church apostate? There is only one answer. It's a problem of hearing. You see, if you're hearing others other than the Holy Spirit, okay, if you are being dazzled by Christian television, and there's nothing wrong with Christian television. I'm not against Christian television. Okay? I am against you being dazzled by Christian television. Christian television is good. It has its purpose. It has its own place in the body of Christ, in the kingdom, and it does a good work. Okay? But when it dazzles you, when it puts you under a spell so that you are spending 4 to 6 hours a day watching it rather than reading your Bible or pursuing a work with the Holy Spirit or a relationship with the Holy Spirit, there's a problem there. You're under a spell of religious witchcraft. And that spell is going to open you up to the spirit of error. And Paul said, by this we know the spirit of truth from the spirit of error. Notice what he said. We know. We know. We know the spirit of truth from the spirit of error. So how is it that so many people don't know? Because the fact is they don't know, and that's why they're apostate. What happened? Intimacy with Christ has been substituted with chasing after personalities. Getting ears tickled from this personality or that personality. See? And by the way, the same thing happens here with me. Don't come here to chase me as a personality thinking that I'm going to tickle your ears, because I don't give these sermons. The Lord Jesus Christ gives the sermons through me. So keep your eyes on him, right? You see? That's why I never prepare sermons. Never have, never will. Because then the work would be coming from me. Huh? But I have to decrease, be an empty vessel, and let the Holy Spirit move through me and speak through me. That's why I yield to the Holy Spirit before the service, that he will do that. And obviously he's doing that. Okay? So, watch this. The whole point is it's intimacy that makes us go into the courtroom. Say. Now here's something for thought. So we've got to cooperate with him. And if we cooperate, now watch this. If we cooperate with the Holy Spirit, there is nothing that we cannot do in him. Nothing we cannot do in him. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. We can then do all things. We can then do all things. Okay? Now, we said that the work of the cross makes it possible. And through that, we can become born again and we can begin the walk of intimacy, and we can start to walk and talk with the Lord just as Adam and Eve did in the garden in the cool of the afternoon. Because the garden fall has been set aside, and the pre-fall conditions of the Garden of Eden have been restored by the finished work of the cross. So we can walk and talk with God. So the first thing that makes it possible for us to walk into the courtroom of God is the fact that we have intimacy with Him. And intimacy means that we trust Him. And guess what happens when two people trust each other? They begin to confide in each other. Huh? And Jesus will be your confidant, and you will be Jesus' confidant. Isn't that something? And there will be secrets spoken. And that's according to the Word of God, huh? It says, His secrets are with those that fear Him, those that rever Him, hold Him in awe, hold Him in respect. Did you know the verse says God wants to talk secrets to you? See? God will talk secrets to you. And what does all this do? This intimacy of the born-again experience, baptism in the Holy Spirit, which starts relationship, okay, and leads you into the Holy of Holies, which is fellowship, okay, the three stages of development of your faith walk, okay? You're at the eastern gate of the tabernacle, that's introduction to Jesus, huh? And coming to Jesus at the altar of incense, right, the cross. Then you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit comes on you. So now you've got the Holy Spirit within, the Holy Spirit upon. And now what you have is relationship with the Holy Spirit, relationship with Jesus. And as you grow, that will bring you into the Holy of Holies, where you will fellowship with God, where secrets will be exchanged, where loving words will be spoken to each other, where kisses will be given to each other, where hugs will be given, embraces, where He will romance you and you will romance Him in a holy way. And what is that called? That's called communion. Communion. Communing with God, and God communing with you, you see. Before you can go into the court of heaven, you have to have a relationship with God. Being born again and spirit-filled is good enough for God. He'll use that, because the rest is just developing your faith walk and your growth individually. But you must be in line with God's Word and God's will. Now, that communion, okay, is with the person of the Holy Spirit, huh? Okay? And so how does that communion work? What does the Holy Spirit do? Well, He is the Spirit of God. Of God. What does that mean? Being God's Spirit, He comes from God. Okay? And where does He come to? You. Me. And what does He do? He goes to God and he talks with the Father. And the Father tells Him things about you and me. And the Father tells Him the plan for your life and my life. And the Father tells Him what He wants done at this moment in time. And the Father tells Him what needs that He wants to be fulfilled in you and me. And then the Holy Spirit comes, and He indwells us in our tabernacle, our Holy of Holies, which is our spirit man. And what does he do? He ministers it to our spirit man. And he works it in our spirit man. You see? And so we have a constant love relationship and romance going between Father God and the Holy Spirit in us and the Lord Jesus Christ. And he is working a work. You see, he is just like an attorney here on earth had to go to law school before he could go into a court, okay? The Holy Spirit has to do a work in you and me before we can go into the court of heaven. You see? And so he does it. 2 Corinthians 13:14. Listen up. We got time yet. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Notice what it says. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. The love of God be with you. And the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you. See, this is all biblical, folks. The Holy Spirit goes to Father God and he communes with Father God, finds out all about you that Father God wants done at this moment in time, brings it back to you and works it in you, communing with you. Communion. The word communicate comes from that. You see? And then the Holy Spirit starts working in you and he starts working on you and he starts ministering to you what you need to do. And what is he doing? He is carrying out the plan of the Father for your life. See? He's equipping you. He's equipping you. You see? These are the things that make it possible for you to enter the court of heaven. Okay? Watch this. In James, well, let me go back a minute here. What the Holy Spirit is doing, okay, with this communion, he's showing you the Father. He's showing you the Son. He's showing you himself. You see? And the more he does it, the more familiar you become. The more familiar you become, the more intimate you become. The more intimate you become, the more you are able to understand what God's plan for your life is. Say, you don't understand God's plan for your life when you're just starting your faith walk. You know that, don't you? You haven't gone along far enough to know what God is doing. Okay? But as you proceed in your faith walk and the years pass, okay, all of a sudden you start seeing certain things unfolding and you know what God is doing. Say. Because it's already in you. God's plan for your life is already in you. The Holy Spirit is in you and he is carrying it out. Huh? So we have to receive and we have to believe what the Holy Spirit is revealing to us. Huh? We have to receive, we have to believe what the Holy Spirit is revealing to us. Now watch this. 1 Corinthians 2:9 to 12. But as it is written, eye has not seen nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. But God has revealed them unto us by his Spirit. Didn't we just say that? He goes to the Father, huh? And brings what the Father wants to us and starts working it in us. God has revealed it to us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man save the spirit of a man, which is in him? Even so, the things of God knows no man but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. So why have we received the Holy Spirit? That we may know the things of God, that we may know the Father, that we may know the Son, that we may know the Holy Spirit, that we may know who we are in Christ. Wow. And it is a work that is being worked in us. You see? And here's one point. The privilege of the court of heaven is that it is a training ground for us. And the more you use it, the more you come to know who you are in Christ. The more you see God's authority working in you and through you, the more you come to know who you are in Christ. Wow. God has revealed these things to us, these verses say. And why does he show it to us? To bring it into reality, to actualize it in our lives. That's why. Now watch this. In James 4, 4 and 5, we read, "You adulterers and adulteresses, know you not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Do you think that the scripture says in vain, the spirit that dwells in us lusts to envy?" What does that mean? The spirit, the Holy Spirit in us lusts, desires for us to envy, to jealousy. God is jealous for us. Did you know that? God is jealous. He yearns for us. He is jealous for us. What is his duty? His duty is to take possession of all of our life for the Father. That's what the Holy Spirit is doing. You see, you and I don't realize it. But the day that you said yes to Jesus, you surrendered all of your life to him. Your life is not your own anymore. It's his. The day that you said yes to Jesus, you surrendered your life to him. And now he has the license to take all of it. He has the license to possess you and all of you. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. You see, there was a trade-off there when you came to the cross and you received Jesus. That's when the great decision for salvation was made, and there was a trade-off. Jesus reserved the license to take all of you, and he took all of you. And in turn, he gave you his Holy Spirit. That's a good deal, isn't it? Okay? And why is that a good deal? Because God's plan for your life is greater than any plan that you could have for yourself. That's why. God's plan is greater than any that you could have for yourself. So now you have the Spirit on you, huh? So you're a transdimensional man, a transdimensional woman. You have access to the kingdom. You have access to the court of heaven. Huh? You have access directly to Jesus. You can commune with the Holy Spirit. Other men who do not, and women that who do not know Jesus, okay? They don't have access. They operate in one dimension, the physical dimension. Okay? You operate in the physical dimension and the spiritual dimension. Okay? You can operate in the kingdom of God and you can operate in the kingdom of Satan and bind him. You are transdimensional. You have the Holy Spirit in you. The Holy Spirit moves in you. Okay? When someone from the world who does not know God speaks, his words move the world. When you have the Holy Spirit in you, your words move the Spirit. Your words move the spirit realm. Your words move the kingdom of God to act on your behalf. There's a difference. You are a person of power. You are a person of authority. You are a person who has court authority. Now watch this. Here's an interesting thought. When you gave yourself to Jesus, you and I didn't really give everything to him. There are certain things we held back. Okay? But when you get mature enough and you grow in your knowledge of Jesus and you start walking in the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus says, those things that you didn't surrender to me, you want to give them to me? Huh? When? You want to give them to me? Why would he ask such a question? Okay? When you are completely his, okay? When you are completely his, then you have authority to move things in the realm of the Spirit, to change things over there, not just here. God can cause you to make things happen in the spirit realm. And when they manifest on the earthly realm, people will be confounded and they'll say, how did that happen? What caused that to happen? See, you stay humble. Okay? When you start moving in that kind of power, you stay humble. Okay? People say, what caused that to happen? Okay? Don't go and steal God's glory, huh? In the process. Okay? No. Stay humble. Stay humble. Sometimes it's better to say nothing. See? But God will use you that way. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean you have to empty your house? You have to give up everything that you own and everything that you like? No. No. What Jesus means when he says, you know, surrender those things that you've held on to. Okay. He's talking about those things that you do that mean so much to you, that are so important to you, that they interfere with your relationship with him. Say, why? because that's an idol. You know what an idol is by definition? Anything which interferes with your relationship with Jesus. That's an idol. Okay? Anything. You can make an idol out of sex, out of money, out of your job, out of your occupation, huh? Out of your career, right? Out of your intellect, your will, your emotions. I mean, you can make an idol, sex. I mean, you can make an idol out of everything, just about. And so what you have to understand is that that's what God wants you to surrender, okay? If it's not an idol, okay, then God knows it's not an idol, and you don't have to surrender it, you see? I mean, like a hobby, okay? If God asks you, give up your hobby, okay? If God asks me, my hobby's photography. If God asks me to give up photography, okay? I mean, I like photography. I enjoy photography, okay? Do I need photography? No. If God said to me, give up photography today, could I do it? Yes. And I'd say, and take my cameras too. See? Because I won't let anything control me by God's grace. You see? And the same thing with art. Okay? A lot of you know that I do art. And if I draw or I paint or something like that, and God said, give it all up. Okay? Would I give it up? Oh, of course, if you wanted me to. Why? I'm not that attached to it to begin with. See? I want to be attached only to Jesus. See? But when we are ready, when we are ready to give up those things which to which we are attached, those things that we didn't surrender when we first got born again, okay, then God will move us into the supernatural fully. When He possesses us fully, we will move into the supernatural fully. And that's what He meant when He said, draw near unto me, I will draw near unto you. Huh? And that's a mathematical proportion, 1-to-1. So if you draw a little near to Jesus, you get a little experience of Jesus. If you draw a little more to Jesus, you get more experience of Jesus. If you draw a lot close to Jesus, you get a lot of experience of Jesus in the Holy Spirit. See? And you can reach a point where you are communing with Jesus all day long, all night long, and you're never out of the Holy of Holies. Always in the Holy of Holies. You may be working, okay? Maybe you're building something with a hammer and a nail, and you're in your shop and you're assembling something, but in your spirit, man, you're in the Holy of Holies. Fellowshipping with Jesus. Fellowshipping with Jesus. And let me tell you something. You may be working, but you may, while you're working and hammering or doing whatever you're putting together, you may be in the Holy of Holies, and you may be speaking spirituals, as Paul calls them in Corinthians, meaning spirit-filled words backed by faith. And you may be praying and releasing spiritual words. And you will release those spiritual words and they will find their target, and you will move something in the spirit realm, like the Holy Spirit has promised for those who are totally surrendered. Okay? And you'll move something in the spirit realm and it will affect somebody's life and they will be blessed. See? And you're still in the physical realm doing this, and your spirit man is praying the things of the spirit and releasing things. You see? Ultimately, do you know what we are called for? And this is why we are able to go into the courtroom of heaven. The reason is because once the Spirit indwells us, and once the communion has begun, and once we are fellowshipping with the Holy Spirit, and we are tuned in and being led by the Holy Spirit, once all of that happens, okay, the manifest presence of God is upon us. Okay? And we are called to bring those judgments, execute those judgments that God has made for the earth to bring them and release them upon the earth. Okay? And how do we do that? We do it with our words. We do it with our ministry. We do it through intercessory prayer. But the greatest thing that God calls us to do, okay, is to manifest the presence that is on us to others. Did you get that? To manifest the presence that is on us to others. Now that's an important thing. Okay? And sometimes we may see someone who is poor, say a street person, sitting on the grass by a building or something like that, and he doesn't know God, and there's no one to pray for him. And what do? We manifest the presence by praying for him, maybe talking to him, maybe giving him some money for food. Okay? Most important, standing at him, looking at him, and saying and declaring, in that day you will decree a thing. It will be established for you. It will be established for you. Doesn't say it may be. Doesn't say it might be. It says it will be established for you. So if our calling is to bring the manifest presence of God to the people of the earth, and we see someone like that in such a terrible condition, and Job 22:30 says, one who is not innocent will be saved because of the cleanness of your hands. Operate in the word of God. Operate in the manifest presence of God. And say to that man, I release the manifest presence of God upon you in the name of Christ Jesus. And I promise you, that man's life will turn around and it will never again be the same. That's what it takes to walk in the power of the Spirit. That's the kind of authority that it takes to bring God's judgments and execute His orders upon the earth, as Psalm 149 says. You see? That is the power that we are called to operate in. Okay? I'll give you a quick example of this. I had to use this last night. I forgot to tell you about this. I got a telephone call. A woman had been receiving deliverance at another church, and at the end of the deliverance, she was crazier than she was before they brought her into the deliverance, and the pastor and the people said, well, she needs a doctor now. We can't help her. This is the most we can do for her. And so she ended up in the hospital, and a nurse called me that knows me and who's a Christian and said, this person's demon-possessed, and she's tearing up the hospital. And she's belligerent, she's combative, we've got her in bed restrained. And the mother and father are born again, and they really need help. And we're wondering if you could do anything. So I said, give me your name. So she gave me her name. And so I said, hang up, call me back in 7 minutes. I said, I have to go into prayer. Okay. And so went into prayer and bound Satan. The whole hierarchy down to the strong man on assignment to or through this person, and then all of the spirits in the stronghold, and God gave me the discernment what they were. And I bound them one and one and one. And I went in the spirit. See, now this is manifesting the presence. See? And I went in the spirit to that person, and I spoke to those spirits. And I bound the strong man. I said, I bind you, and I bind you, spirit of so-and-so, 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 so-and-so. I break your powers. I command you to loose her in the name of Christ Jesus. I Break your communication lines. I break your supply lines. I bind up and off all reinforcements. I curse your works and ministry, and I command you to shut up and stop ministering to her, and do it now in the name of Christ Jesus. And you all obey in Christ Jesus' name. I box, cage, gag, and paralyze you until she can be delivered in the name and by the blood of Christ Jesus. Ministering angels of the Lord Christ Jesus, go to her and minister peace and comfort and quietness to her right now in Christ Jesus' name. And warrior angels of the Lord Jesus Christ, go to those spirits, box, cage, gag, paralyze them, and hold them captive and prisoner to Christ until she can be delivered in the name and by the blood of Christ Jesus. I decree all warrior angels of the Lord Christ Jesus, go forth now and cause these prayers to be, dear friends, in Christ Jesus' name. And I finished, and within 30 seconds, ding, the phone rings. And I call, and I pick up the phone, and I said to the nurse, "How's she doing?" And she says, "The combativeness has stopped. She's perfectly quiet and sleeping." Say, perfectly quiet and sleeping. Say, there's no distance or space or time in the spirit realm. You can go to them and you can deal with them. Say, the authority is with you, not with them. They're powerless. They were defeated at the cross 2,000 years ago. Their power was taken from them. Say, so you have that authority. Okay? And what was I really doing? I was executing the judgments of the Father that have already been written. We read about that earlier, didn't we? You see? I was executing those judgments against them. See? When you know who you are in Christ, you know the power is with you, not with the enemy. Not with the enemy. Okay? Not with the enemy. So, that brings us to the last thing I want to speak of today, and that is realize that the anointings that we have on us, okay, are for the purpose of the kingdom and the glory of the Father. See, that anointing yesterday was for the glory of the Father. See, and when I got the report, the first thing I said was, "The glory is yours, Father God." You see, the glory is yours. Well, that's as far as we can go today. We'll discuss more about this in our next session. And I'll continue to show you the points that permit us to go in to the court of heaven and why that born-again experience at the cross created the circumstance for us to do these things through intimacy and fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll talk more about this in our next session. Father, we give you all the thanks, praise, and glory for the revelation of your word and the purpose of your spirit. We bless your name. We ask that you walk before us this week, Father, in all that we do and say. Live your life in us and through us. Guide us. Show us what to minister, if to minister, how to minister, what to say, if to say it. Show us points of ministry. Open the doors to all that we are to do. Close the doors to anything we are not to do. We empty ourselves, vessels for your use. We yield to your Holy Spirit. We give you all of the glory, and we give you the greatest of thanks and praise. And the saints say in agreement, amen. We want to thank the members of our radio listening audience. You've been listening to the Sunday morning teaching coming to you from Word of Faith Ministries International in Miami, Florida. We invite you to tune in next Sunday where we will continue our teaching on the DNA of God in the court of heaven. And we also invite you to tune in Wednesday night at 8 o'clock on the internet. It's Eastern Standard Time for Bible study at Word of Faith. And Friday night at 8 o'clock for discipleship class here at Word of Faith. Until then, God bless you. Have a great week. Bye-bye.